our last session, what we did is take a look at the idea of the college experience. And what we saw was that there's three things that are going to make it memorable: the decisions you make about your career, about your friends, and about your faith. But we also some challenges, four challenges you're going to face. Three overwhelming feelings, which is loneliness, freedom, and stress. We got two common temptations, which are alcohol and sex. We saw one consistent argument that the Bible records are not historically reliable and that you're facing all of this with zero community. Now, we're on page 7 in your manuals. So in this session, we're going to think about what does it mean to own our faith by wearing big shoes? Does that make absolute sense to everybody? Yeah. To own your faith, you're going to need to learn how to wear big shoes. Several years ago, my wife and I started on a basement remodel project, and it's going on over 7 years right now, and it's still not finished. Does anybody have a dad like that that's got a kind of an open-ended project out there? And yeah, okay, I see those hands. And I see those faces of disappointment, by the way, which is motivating me to finish this so when my kids are in high school, they won't go, "Dad, finish the basement, please." What was interesting was that when we started this basement remodel project, we're ripping stuff up and we're tearing things apart. We're going through boxes. And while we're going through all these boxes and trying to figure out what we've got, we came across this. Yeah, this is the time when all the guys go, "Oh." This is my son Jack's shoes. Jack is right in the middle of two girls. And this is when he was 18 months old. It's his little boat shoe. I don't know why he has a boat shoe. We don't have a boat, but he looked cool in it for a little while. And what's interesting is looking at this, I'm like going, "Oh my gosh, this is when he was 18 months. Jack is now in third grade. And one of these days, he's going to wear a shoe like this." Yeah, I know. Hopefully it'll look a lot cooler and be a little more fresh smelling. But the point is that my son Jack is growing up, and there's nothing he can do to change that. There's nothing I can do to change that. And what's happening is that you all are growing up. You are going to go off to a place that's filled with adult privileges, freedoms, and responsibilities when you go off to college. And the question to think about is, how are you doing on the inside? Are you ready to handle those kinds of opportunities and privileges as an adult? In this session, there's three things that I want to suggest that will help you become the right person and wear these big shoes. And those three things are that you're going to need a badge, you're going to need some guts, and you're going to need a mask. So let's figure out how this is going to work on becoming a person who can wear those big shoes, all right? First thing that you're going to need, like I said, is the idea of having a badge. So really, the idea behind that is the idea of having personal authority in your life. So the little line that you're looking for is the idea of authority, okay? To have a badge means to have personal authority. We need to understand, letter A, that God wants you to be in charge of your life. He's made it to where He wants to see you take ownership and be in charge of what's going on inside of your life, all right? Would someone read for us? There's a passage right there in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 16. Would someone read that for us? Just take that initiative. Thank you. Actually, it's in your notes if you want to read it in your notes. Yeah. Ephesians chapter 4, 11 through 16.
All right. "It was He who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, and some to be pastors and teachers, to prepare God's people for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of men in their deceitful scheming."
Okay, thank you very much. Now, Paul was writing this letter to this church in Ephesus, and you can tell by his answer, they're probably going like, "All right, now who are you guys again? And why do you always come to our place? And there's different one of you guys, and you're all, who are you? What do you do?" He said, "Look, God's put all of us in your life, some in different roles, for one purpose." Look down through your notes. Right in the middle there, it says, it's the idea to become mature. Do you see that? He said that God has put all these spiritual leaders in your life for one reason, to become mature. Find that phrase and circle it, become mature. And what Paul does is he contrasts this idea by saying that we are to no longer be infants. Would you find that line and underline that? So God wants us to grow up. He doesn't want us to stay infants in our faith. And look how he describes the idea of being an infant. They're tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching. It's kind of like if you ever saw that movie Forrest Gump, you know?
You know, Mama, I don't know if I'm supposed to have a destiny like Lieutenant Dan, or if I'm like floating along in the breeze like a feather. What's my destiny, Mama? You know, remember that?
He says, what happens is kids are pushed around. Kids are gullible. And he says, I don't want you to be prey to the cunning and craftiness of men in their deceitful scheming. Some of you are going to go to a college where there are people on the faculty who really believe it's their responsibility to separate you from your Christian worldview. They think that your view of the world is archaic and you need to be enlightened. And what Paul is saying is that God wants you to grow up. He wants us to grow up and not be infants, but become mature. My son Jack, like I said, is kind of sandwiched right between a couple of girls, and so there's a way in which he and I connect more because we're the only guys in the family. And a lot of times Jack likes to imitate what I'm doing. I remember one time we were working on this kitchen remodel project, and we're laying down the subflooring, and he's got his little plastic hammer, and he's trying to drive these nails. The guy's getting nowhere, but you know, he's having fun beating on them. Another time he wanted to shave with me. So I got Jack all loaded up with shaving cream and everything, and then I had handed him his Mach 7 razor, and he's cutting his face, and he's bleeding. It was really cute. No, I didn't do that. That's horrible. Of course I didn't do that. Gosh, that's, what kind of dad would I be? I gave him his little Scooby-Doo razor. So he took his little Scooby-Doo razor, and Jack is shaving like this. He's put his hand right here, and he starts shaving. Now, the reason he's doing that is because when I shave, I put my hand right here, and I don't know why I put my hand right there. I think it's maybe to feel the muscles, the manliness, the hugeness. Oh, look, I've got the pectoral muscle. When I move my arm here, it feels huge and bulging, yeah. It's a little bit of the hair, maybe a furry guy, yeah. So Jack is shaving like this. I don't know why, but I do that. Well, one of the things that we like to do in our family was to play the crocodile hunter. And how that basically worked was that I was the crocodile hunter, and our kids absolutely loved Steve Irwin, totally missed him when he left. It was horrible. But we would play it, and the idea was that as the crocodile hunter, I would chase all the kids throughout the house. And if I found them, I would bring them back to the zoo, which was the bath, okay? Now, if I caught them, they had to help me catch the other kids and bring them back. So my oldest was the little Sheila, Jack was the little Booger, and our youngest, Sydney, was the little Joey. Now, I told the kids to all go out and hide. And what's great is that when kids are ready, if you ever have kids, you'll see this someday. But when they're ready, they go, okay, Dad, we're ready, which totally gives away where they're hiding. It's awesome. So I know exactly where they are. And so when it was time for them to start, I said, okay, are you guys ready? Because here I come. And then I'd start out like this. All right, mates, I'm the crocodile hunter. And I'm looking for the little Bigger, the little Sheila, and the little Joey. And I know you got huge, sharp, dangerous, pointy fangs. They got venom that is dangerous. It could kill me instantly. But I got the anti-venom in my back pocket, so I'm not worried about you, mates. And I come up to my little son, who's 3 years old. And I'm like, all right, I got you, little Bigger. Now you got to help me find your sisters, right, mate? And my three-year-old son in his best little Australian goes, right, mate. Oh, it was awesome. Because he just loved playing right or wrong. That's what kids are like. But it's the same part of kids that scares me to death. Because my son and my daughter could be out on a playground somewhere, and someone could walk up to them with a picture of a puppy and say, I've lost my puppy. You come and help me find him. You see, kids are gullible. And they might just go with this guy because they're gullible. And Paul is saying that God wants us to grow up. He doesn't want us to be gullible. He wants us to take charge of our life. He wants you to be in charge of your life. What does that mean? Well, looking at your notes, the freedom to make all the decisions of your life without seeking someone else's permission first. You know, when you go off to college, you're not going to be calling mom saying, Mom, should I wear the blue outfit today? Is that okay? You know, you're not going to say, Dad, I was up till 4 in the morning. I'm going to sleep in for a class. Is that okay? You know, you're not going to do that stuff. You're going to have the freedom to make all kinds of choices without finding anyone's permission. That's what it means to be in charge. But it also means the responsibility to accept the consequences of your choices. So if you're going to play Xbox all day Saturday and get further behind in your reading, that's your choice. You got to own that. So God wants us to be in charge of our lives, to accept the freedom and the responsibility. But it also means that we understand this, letter B, that God wants you to remember that He is ultimately in charge. That even though He wants us to have a sense of being in charge of our lives, He wants us to remember that He is ultimately in charge. There's a passage in your notes from Matthew chapter 23, verses 5 through 10. Would someone be willing to read this for us? How about, yes, sir, I see that hand. Thank you. Would you mind reading that for us?
Yeah. Everything they do is done for men to see. They make their
phylacteries. Big word.
wide and the tassels on their garments long. They loved the place of honor at banquets and the most important seats in the synagogue. They loved to be greeted in the marketplaces and to have men call them rabbi. But you are not to be called rabbi, for you have only one master, and you are all brothers. And do not call anyone on earth father, for you have one father, and he is in heaven. Nor are you to be called teacher, for you have one teacher, the Christ.
Thank you very much. So Jesus is with his followers, and they're looking at the Pharisees, who are the Jewish religious leaders of the day, and he's kind of watching what they do and how they live their life and how they lead other people spiritually. Does anybody know what a phylactery is? It comes from the idea taken in the Old Testament where God commanded the Jews, he said, I want you to have my word on your mind and on your hearts at all time. So what they did was they made these little boxes, and they'd take their favorite Bible verses and write them down on 3x5 animal skins. And they'd put them in these little boxes, and they would tie the box to their head, and they would tie the box on their arm, so that way God's word would be on their mind and on their heart, or close to their heart, near their heart kind of thing, at all times. Now, do you think that's what God had in mind with that verse? I don't think so. And then what would they do is walk around and they check each other's boxes out. Yeah. They're like, oh my goodness, did you see Jacob's box? It's huge. It's like a Nike basketball box. That guy really loves God. He's got the Psalms in there. He's got all the Old Testament prophets and stuff. And then they'd walk to this guy. Oh, look at little Benjamin. He's got like a matchbox. He doesn't love God. So they would check all these things out, and they'd live their lives externally. And Jesus said, I don't want you to be like those guys. Even though they're your leaders, don't see them as your leaders. Don't call anyone on earth rabbi. Don't even call anyone on earth your father. Does anybody find that weird? I mean, when I became a Christian and read that verse, I thought, okay, what am I going to call my dad? If I call my dad Pete, he's going to hit me, okay? So what is he talking about? What he's trying to tell his disciples is that you have one ultimate authority. Now, God's put people in charge of you at certain times of your life, like parents and pastors and teachers and all kinds of people, but you've got to remember as you grow up, there is one ultimate person in charge of you, and that's God himself, and to understand that. So what that means is being in charge of your life begins with seeing God as your ultimate authority and seeing yourself as equal with other people, not under their authority. Now, like I said, God's going to put you in a spot where you have to report to people like your parents, your boss, you know, professors, but he wants you to always remember that he's ultimately in charge. Look at this quotation from a Christian counselor who's talked with a lot of people to think this through. He said that everyone who has ever lived has encountered a particular problem being born a little person in a big person's world and being given the task of becoming a big person over time. We are all born children under adult authority and over time are to become authorities ourselves and be in charge of our lives. In other words, we all start off little and we have to grow up. Now, I have a picture here that kind of depicts this. You know, I want you to not be a little overwhelmed. I was an art minor in college, okay? So I feel that the stick figure represents kind of the angst of the 21st century existence. The yellowness is a real sense of gauntness that nihilism brings in. Anyways, they're just stick people. Okay, so this is what it is. All of us are raised like this. We're born little people in a big person's world, okay? And this little arrow, you know what that represents? That's the power. See, mom and dads have all the power in the relationship. So when my daughter, Sydney, comes and says, Dad, I just want to wear a cape to school. No. When my son says, Dad, can I stay up late and watch Craig Ferguson with you? I say, no. When my daughter, Lauren, says, I'm going to miss piano today. I'm going to say, no, you're not. When my daughter, Sydney, says, I don't want to wear that. We say, sweetheart, you can wear this or you can wear this. What's your choice? You see, my wife and I have all the power, and it's sweet. But if we're going to be good parents, we have to learn how to give more and more power to our kids so they can have more and more control over their lives. And you, right now, are at the zenith of this. It's called adolescence. You can feel it, can't you? You can feel it when your mom says, you're wearing that. You're like, you're going out with who? You're feeling this pull, aren't you, to just go, man, I want some room here. That's the way God's designed it, to help you get more and more power so you can leave and start your own life. By the way, here's the little Bigger and the little Sheila and the little Joey. Aww. Don't look too close. The tub's really dirty. Anyway, so what God wants us to experience, especially when we go off to college, is the idea that even though you're 18, you're on the same level as someone who's 50, who's written 15 books, and has two PhDs. Okay? They're not in charge of you. You have the right to your own opinion, your own thoughts, your own beliefs. You can talk to them. You can disagree with them. You're on the same level because God's in charge of everybody. But what happens is people go off to college, and even though they look like young adults on the outside, on the inside, they're still little. They still don't know how to own their life and own their feelings and own their decisions. And what will happen is they get there and they let other people make all the decisions because there are little on the inside. See, this is what makes it difficult for a gal who's in the backseat of a car or in a dormitory with somebody going farther than she wants to sexually. She has a hard time saying no because on the inside she feels little, like, what if I say no, they won't like me? Or when a guy is being invited by some friends to go out to the party and do all kinds of stuff, and he knows he wants to say no, but he can't on the inside because he feels little, that if I say no, they're not going to like me. And the thing is that God wants us to grow up. He wants us to take charge of our lives, okay? What I want to have you do right now is I have a little exercise for you. You should find a piece of rope near you. First thing I want you to do is pair up with someone. You got to pair up with your neighbor. And there might be some tables of five, so we might have to work that out. I'll explain to you in a moment what that was all about, but I'm glad that you had a nice little break, okay? So to wear big shoes, you're going to need to have a badge and have some personal authority. The second thing you're going to need is to have some guts. You're going to need to have a little bit of courage, okay? And there's a few ways you need to think about this. First of all, you're going to need the courage to distinguish yourself from other authorities. If God wants you to be authority and an authority over your life, guess what? Other people are authorities too, okay? So he wants you to have the courage to distinguish yourself from those other authorities. Now, what is an authority? An authority really is a definition. It's someone who wants to influence what you do or believe, okay? So you can have good authorities, right? And you can have bad authorities. But authority is basically, that's what someone's trying to do, is trying to influence what you do and what you think. So what are the authorities that you're going to face while you're in college? There's actually three of them. What you're going to see is the authorities are your professors, your parents, and your peers. You're going to have professors, especially at state schools, who will tell you the way the world is about evolution or about politics or whatever. So they're going to try to influence you that this is how you should think. You might even be at a Christian liberal arts school where there's a particular politics or a particular view of the Bible that you're going to be said, this is the way it is. So they're going to try to influence you. Your parents, that is a big one. It's a difficult one. It's tough because, you know, that's you're in their home and you're growing up and God wants you to honor them. But what happens if somewhere around your junior year in college, God wants you to go on some missions trip to Scotland to go out and meet and greet the people of Scotland and bring the gospel to them? What are you going to do then, huh? And your father says, well, you really need to get that internship, you know, because if you want to get the job, you got to have the... You're going to have to decide, well, do I do what God wants me to do this summer, or should I follow what my dad's saying? Okay? Hopefully you can work that out. But the point is that you've got these parents' as authorities. Now, let me just say one thing real quick. For those of you who are going off to a community college or a junior college and are staying at home, if you're living with your parents after high school and you're using their hot water, and you're eating their groceries, and their electricity, and you're on their car thing and their insurance, then you need to respect their rules. Because you're still under their authority. You're still living with them and taking up all that stuff. If you don't like their rules, if you don't like the system there at home, that's fine. That means you're getting bigger and you want to get your own thing. What that means then is it's time to move out. But the point is that part of these authorities God wants us to figure out is how to be different from our parents and find out who we are. And last one, the biggest one really is the idea that you're going to feel is your peers. That your friends at college are going to want to go here and want to go there. They're going to influence what you think and how you live, especially on the weekends. So those are the authorities that you're going to face. You're going to need the courage to distinguish yourself from them. But you're also going to need the courage to be able to say, no, I disagree, or no, thank you to these authorities. For example, if you have a professor who's telling you one thing about life that you don't believe, you need to be respectful to say, you know, I don't see it that way. This is what I think. Even if it means they might take you down on a grade, is to have the courage to disagree with them, even though you're thinking, well, I'm only 18 and I've just in college and I don't know anything about this topic and they've written all these books. Hey, you have an opinion, don't you? Develop your critical thinking. Find out what you think and be willing to say, you know what, I disagree and here's why. Or to be able to say no, thank you. What if new acquaintances at colleges say, hey, we're all going to do this. You want to come with us? You'll need to have the courage to say, well, no, I really don't want to. Unfortunately, what a lot of people your age do is they don't know how to say no. And so when someone says, come on, we're all going to the party, they're like, well, I don't know if I should, maybe I shouldn't. And they just kind of go, okay, cool, whatever. And they just go. Or maybe sometimes they overreact and they go, you're going to a party? Is there alcohol at that party? Alcohol's bad. It's evil. God hates alcohol. God hates anyone near alcohol. And I don't want to be near alcohol if you're going there, and then I don't want to be near you. So no, get away from me. You know? It's like that's how they say no. And you know what? You can say no differently. You can say it respectfully. You can say, hey, guys, thank you for inviting me to the party that you'd want me to hang out with you on Friday night. Man, thank you. But I just don't feel like going. I'll catch up with you guys tomorrow. See how you can say no respectfully and still offer a relationship to them. So you're going to need that courage to say no, to separate yourself from these authorities and figure out what you want to do and not be influenced by those others. I want to show you a clip from somebody who is really, really good at saying no. And I'm hoping that this little clip will help give you the kind of courage that you'll need to be able to say no to. Okay? So let's watch this. You know, that is a guy who is not afraid to say no, isn't he? Homie may be a clown, but he don't make a fool out of himself. And the thing is, you're going to need to know how to have the courage to say no to people at certain times for certain reasons. And that's going to require some courage. Letter C, you're also going to see that you'll need courage to be different when you feel disappointment from these authorities. Because you know what's going to happen if you come to a Friday night and people are going to the party and you really think you shouldn't go or just don't want to go, what are they going to say? Oh, come on, man, everybody's going. The whole floor is going. Come on, man. And you'll just feel their hooks sink right into you and just start pulling you with them because their disappointment's going to make you go, oh, okay, I guess so. And that's when you'll need the courage the most to say, no, thanks for inviting me. But I don't want to go, guys. I'll catch up with you tomorrow. Now, when we did this, I was curious, how many people liked being on this side where you're pulling people around? How many? Anybody? What'd you like about it?
You had the freedom to take them where you wanted.
Okay. What else? Anybody on this end? What'd you like?
You got to choose your own pace.
Yeah. I like that. What about on this end? How did it feel to be on this side?
Interesting.
It hurt. Who was your partner? Oh, man. Yes.
You didn't have to make decisions.
You didn't have to make any decisions. It's kind of nice, wasn't it? You just kind of coast a little bit. Yeah. You know what this symbolizes? Peer pressure. You see, that's what peer pressure is. What happens is that when we hand other people the rope, we're saying, you're in charge of me. You can do anything you want, and I'll follow you because you are in charge. Now, some of you got hurt, didn't you? Because you'll be maybe hanging out with people. They're going to pull you in places you don't really want to go, but you're saying, you're in charge. I'll go where you want to go. And what's interesting, sometimes it might be fun to let other people in charge, won't it? Because I know what it's like sometimes when you're trying to be constantly vigilant about your faith or about your morals or about your values. And sometimes you just go, man, I just don't want to think that hard. So you take charge. And the point is that to have these big shoes, to live in this environment that you're walking into, you'll need to have the courage to say no when it's appropriate. So you're going to need to have the personal authority or a badge. You're going to need to have a sense of courage or guts. There's a third part that you're going to need as it relates to having these sense of big shoes and walking into this environment called college, and that is that you're going to need to have a mask or a sense of identity. Now, I hope you can follow me on this. This gets a little tricky because normally we think of a mask as something to hide ourselves. So I'm going to ask a question and see if you get the answer. Does anybody know who Bruce Banner, or excuse me, I said that wrong. Does anybody know who the Hulk is? Bruce Banner. Wow, you guys are really smart. That's awesome. Does anybody know who the real Superman is? Clark Kent, yes. Does anybody know who Iron Man is? Tony Stark, yeah, that's right. Anybody know who Batman is? Bruce Wayne. Okay, who is Spider-Man?
Peter Parker.
Okay, now here's the question. Is Peter Parker really who he is when he's wearing his mask or when he's not wearing his mask? How many people think that he really is himself when he's not wearing his mask? That's Peter Parker. How many of you think that? Nobody, or are you just like afraid? How many people think he's really who he is when he's wearing his mask? Some of you, yeah. Well, I would be on your side. That's the right answer. Because you know what's interesting is that when he doesn't have his mask, he can't climb walls, can he? He can't spin webs, can he? He's not free to be who he really is. See, Spider-Man's the guy that got bit by the spider and got genetically altered. His DNA went and all that stuff. So who he really is he's now part spider. And when he puts on that mask, that's who he really is. And as you are going through the season of your life, it's going to be so important for you to keep defining and being clear about who you are, what you're about, what's important to you. Keep building and making a stronger sense of identity about what's important to you, about what you value. I don't know if you've seen this particular movie, but we really like it in our family. So I want you to listen to what Mrs. Incredible says to her kids about this whole idea of the mask that she's given them. Listen. So what did Mrs. Incredible say? Yeah. Mrs. Incredible says your identity is your most valuable possession. Guard it at all costs. Protect it at all costs. And as you're working through the season of your life, it's so important that you figure out what's important to you and why. Because that's one of the most important things you have. That if you let other people shape you and define you, then you're not in charge. Now, this is a little table that shows the story of your life right here, okay? Boom. That's it. Your life squeezed onto a nice little table, nice and neat. You started off as an infant, then you went to preschool, and then you got to kind of more preschool, I guess, then school age, elementary school, and then adolescence. And this is where you are right now, right in middle adolescence. And what's important for you is the group, what the group thinks. How are the people at my table laughing? Are they laughing or not laughing? Are people raising their hand or not raising their hand? How's everybody doing? You want to fit in with the group. That's all about this season of life. But where you're headed is the idea of adulthood. That long thing that goes from 25 years to death. Dun, 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 dun. But what's important in this season is figuring out things like your spouse, your family, your work, about becoming your own person and separating from the herd. I want to ask you a personal question here. You don't have to raise your hand if you don't want to. But when you look down the corridor of your life, how many of you think it'd be kind of nice or you're open to meeting somebody, falling in love, and getting married someday? Some of you, okay? Don't worry, I'm not going to match you up with anybody. Don't worry about that. How many of you, when you look down this corridor of your life, think, you know, it'd be nice to meet somebody, fall in love, and have kids someday? How many people think that way? Kind of open to that, all right? How many people, when they look down the corridor of their life, and they think, I'm going to meet somebody, fall in love, get married, have kids someday, and then after about 5 or 6 years, I want to have a divorce that's really ugly, and it kind of devolves into this big custody battle? How many people want to have that? Yeah. See, not many of us want that at all. But what's interesting is that what's going to help you to have the great marriage and the kind of family that you want to have is meeting the kind of person that's like you. And the thing is, if you work at figuring out what's important to you and what role God's going to play and what role the Bible has in your life, and you really become more and more convinced of that, that's the kind of person you're going to look for. So the more you work on figuring out what's important to you and developing and making your identity stronger, you're going to be led to somebody like that and have a marriage that's strong and a family that's strong. There's a couple of things that you'll need to do as you're working through this idea of developing your identity in the college years, okay? You can go through life and you can be asking questions about life and reflecting a little bit, or you can go through and just kind of go, well, I'm not going to really think too much and ask too many questions. As you're thinking through, you can make some decisions about what you've thought about what's important to you, or you can kind of go through and say, you know what, I'm not really going to make too many decisions. Just kind of leave it open-ended. Now, there's people who have been thinking about life and reflecting about life and made some commitments, and those people are called decided. They have a sense that, wow, this is what I'm about. This is what's important to me. Now, in a room this size, that's probably no one because your stage of life, that's not where you're at yet, and that's okay. You're not really decided about a lot of these different kinds of things. The second group of people are people who've been asking questions and reflecting about life, but haven't really made too many decisions yet. They're still kind of thinking about, you know, what's important and what's not important and all that. These are people that are deciding. This is where a good number of you are right now, because you're trying to figure out life. You're a little open-ended. That's okay. That's where a good percentage of you are. Some of you, on the other hand, are going through life right now. You're not really thinking too much. You're not thinking too deeply or reflecting. You're not making any decisions about your morals, about your values, or anything. And you're people who are drifting. And these are the people who are most likely to have troubles out of high school, because they're the ones who are going to let the crowd define them and decide who they're going to be. And the last group of people, though this is a little hard to understand, but I'll finish out the little quadrants, okay? And that's the idea of people who've made commitments, who have strong beliefs, but they've never really thought too much or had too many questions. And those are people who are declared. And what that basically means is that they've taken the values and the beliefs of their parents, their teachers, or their youth pastor, and they're not really theirs. It's tradition. I'll just do this because we've always done this, and you've never thought too much. Well, where are you in these four spots? If you had to put that you're somewhere, where are you? And secondly, where would you like to be? And what that means is thinking more, reflecting more, making decisions, drawing lines. This is how far I'll go sexually. This is what I think about alcohol. Make some commitments and decisions, because that's defining you and helping you become a stronger person. I don't know if you've seen this movie, Juno. There was a little controversy about it, but she's a person who's a real strong individual. She kind of walks to a beat of a very different drum. Well, I want you to hear this conversation that she had with her dad and stepmom. You see, the reason that this character, Juno, got in the problem that she got into is she had no idea what she believed, really. She was just doing stuff. She said, I have no idea the kind of girl that I am. And the point is that this is your opportunity to clarify and define what's important to you and why, because God wants you to be in charge. He doesn't want other people to be in charge. So work on finding and thinking and making those decisions and drawing those lines and developing those convictions. Our counselor friend again said the idea that adolescents need to question the things mom and dad believe and come up with their own reasons for faith and other values. If their faith does not become their own, they will lose it later or become Pharisees. So carve out what do you believe and why that's separate from mom and dad, separate from youth pastors, separate from your teachers. Now to do that, there's a few things that will help you. There's three steps. First of all is the idea of exploring wisely, okay? You do not have to take crack cocaine a dozen times to find out if it's bad for you, all right? You don't have to get drunk 40 times to find out if it's bad for you. You don't have to have sex before marriage a few times to find out the emotional fallout of that, okay? Explore wisely. Second of all, evaluate carefully. As you go through life and are experiencing these things, having these conversations, thinking about these things, what do you think? What do you think about sex? What do you think about alcohol? What do you think about peer pressure? What do you think about all these ideas, okay? What does the Bible say about these topics? If the Bible's important to you, what does it say? Evaluate that. Put that together. And then lastly is come to a place where you earnestly decide. Draw some lines saying this is how far I'm going to go based on what I think the Bible tells me. This is what I think about alcohol. This is what I'll say when they ask me to the party on Friday night. Make some decisions, because when you make those decisions, you're crafting and defining yourself better. You're getting in touch with your internal homie to say, I don't think so. Homie, don't play that. Well, as you do that, distinguishing yourself from these authorities means defining who you are in the following areas. The first one is the idea of your beliefs. And what that means basically is what the Bible teaches about ultimate reality. What do you believe about God? What do you believe about heaven, about sin, about death? What do you believe? Secondly, what are your convictions? And what that means is how well we own what the Bible teaches about ultimate reality. Sure, it says that, but do you hold on to it very well? Next is your morals. What is right and wrong for all peoples at all times? Is lying always wrong? Is stealing always wrong? Is being drunk always wrong? Is having sex before marriage always wrong? What are your moral convictions? Another area of convictions are what are called gray areas, which means what is right and wrong for one believer but may not be for everyone else. For example, what does the Bible say about smoking? Anything? What does the Bible say about drinking or about dancing? What does the Bible say about dancing? Nothing. Huh? There's no principles that would guide us? There's principles, but you can't go to the chapter and verses, thou shalt not dance, especially if it's R&B. That is strictly forbidden. You have to figure a lot of these things out based on your understanding of the Bible and what God is telling you about your past, all right? Next is the idea of your calling. Man, this is big in college. This is what college is primarily about. What is the Lord leading you to do with your life? Where are you going? What direction? What contribution will you have to His kingdom? That way, as you find out where you're supposed to go in life, once you figure that out, you can move back in with your parents for a couple years and work at Starbucks. No, just kidding. But this is that season for you to figure out your calling. And lastly, who is your Lord? In other words, who is leading your life? Is somebody ultimately in charge or not? God wants you to be in charge, but are you bowing to somebody? And are you bowing to Him? Okay? There is a scene from a movie, again, that I want to show you. I don't know if you've ever seen this one. It's an older movie, Dead Poets Society. It's about a group of men who are in this boarding school, college preparatory school, and they've got this really unique teacher that's trying to get them to think differently. Let's watch this. Just like he says, it's the idea, be different, be willing to be different, have the courage to separate from the crowd and figure out who you are. Even if that means you're being different from somebody else. Define that. Have that clear sense of identity. Last thing I want you to look at in your notes is in Matthew chapter 16. Jesus is spending time with His disciples. And He says, when Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, He asked His disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, Jeremiah or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" He asked. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven." See, Jesus starts with like a little focus group. Guys, what are people saying about me? What's the word on the street? And He hears what everybody else says. Then He takes it one step further and says, "Guys, who do you think that I am?" And I want to take it one step further to you and ask you, who is Jesus Christ to you personally? What difference does He make in your life? Why do you want to follow Him? Why are you interested in Him? You see, if you don't have good reasons for that now, it'll be easier for you when you leave this environment to just wander off. But who is He to you? What does He mean? And I would suggest to you that one of the most important questions for you to resolve as you go through this season of your life and try to really firm up this identity and what you're all about is the question, what role will I let Jesus Christ play in my life? That's the most important thing. Not what your parents think, not what your friends think, but what do you think? You're going to need big shoes when you go off to college. And to have those big shoes, you're going to need to have a sense of authority, you're going to need to have courage, and you need to have a stronger identity. In our next session, what we're going to be taking a look at is how to destroy the university's greatest weapon against Christianity.